Post the colors.
Stand by. Color. Hinge hut. Right shoulder. Arm. Colored. Ready. Cut. Step. Present arm.
Today, for the world of heaven, Father. We ask, Lord, that you be so kind to look down upon us at the time of ceremony. We ask that you be so kind to look and bless Bill and his family, Lord. We ask that you would bless everyone here today. And Lord, we ask that you would be so kind, Lord. We ask that you would, first, we want to thank you for keeping Dale and his family. We thank you, Lord, for keeping him through all these many years that he has served in this Air Force. We thank you, Lord, for keeping him on every TUI. We thank you. We thank you, Lord, for every PCS move, Lord. We thank you today, Lord. We just thank you today for keeping him and his family safe, Lord. And Lord, as he ends this part of his journey in life, Lord, we ask that you would please be so kind to go before him and bless him. Keep him, Lord. We ask that you will make every rough way smooth. We ask that you will make every crooked way straight. And Lord, when the enemy comes, Lord, we pray that you will build a camp of protection around him. as he moves on to this other endeavor of his life and all the coming endeavors, Lord, we ask that you would go before him, Lord. And most of all, we pray, Lord, that you would give Dale and his family, give them the mind, Lord, to always make you the head of their life. We ask, Lord, that you would give them the mind, Lord, to be his anchor. Give him the mind, Lord, to be his pilot. That whatever comes his way, that he would always look to you. That he would always put his trust in you today, Lord. And Father, we ask, Lord, that you would continue to keep him, bless him, lead him, and guide him. And Lord, we ask all these things in your precious Son Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Son, Lord, for those inspiring words. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. You can be seated. Welcome to today's retirement ceremony as we take tribute to Master Sergeant Delvecchio Moses on the occasion of his retirement after 24 years of honorable service in the United States Air Force. The presiding officer for today's ceremony is Lieutenant Colonel Clemens Retire. Honestly, Master Sergeant Curtis Reese retired. I'm honored to serve as the narrator for today's retirement ceremony. Retirement ceremonies are time-honored traditions that formally recognize the completion of active service for military personnel. Throughout the ceremony, you will be given cues to rise and be seated. We are honored to have members of Sergeant Moses' family in attendance. With us today is his wife, Jamie, daughter, London, son, Damaris and Dimitri, mother, Pamela, father, Quincy, mother-in-law, Cassandra, father-in-law, Sam, grandmother, Mrs. Jackson and Mrs. Lowe, sister, Lysandra and Kanaya, brother, Patrice, as well as a host of aunts, uncles, and cousins. Sergeant Moses dedicates this ceremony to his family for the sacrifices they have made in support of his efforts. And of course, we are honored to have all the commanders, chiefs, first sergeants, and other distinguished guests, friends, and colleagues in attendance today. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to introduce Lieutenant Colonel J.C. Clemens, retired. Sir, the floor is yours.
All right. Good afternoon. And thank you for taking the time out of your busy schedule here to join us in celebrating the retirement of Master Sergeant Delvecchio and Moses, the culmination of an outstanding and distinguished career that spanned over 24 years, six duty locations, numerous two TDYs, and many of them had the combat zones. Emory Moses started his career here at Robinson in 1995. The delayed enlister program. He's finished his career up at Lackland Air Force Base, Texas, but he's chosen to retire here at Robbins Air Force Base, where he served 8 out of his 24 years. Dale's the oldest of 5 children, 2 brothers, 2 sisters, and he's the only one that made the military a career. He left home 2 days after his 18th birthday, August 3rd, 1995, and he still refers to it as the toughest decision he's ever made. So it's a great day for the Moses family as they embark on a new journey. A new journey that probably won't change much because his wife, Tremisa, is still on active duty at Joint Base San Antonio, Fort Sam Houston. Once Dale retires, like most retirees, he probably thinks he's gonna be playing a lot of golf, having a lot of fun. But I was playing golf on Monday and I saw Tremisa and she kind of hinted at something different, like hitting that pavement looking for a job. I don't think he can play golf like you think he's going to be doing. She had a big hoodie to list for you, so get ready for that. While it's a great day for the Moses family, it's a sad day for the Air Force because they're going to be losing one of their finest airmen. Dale is what I like to call an impact player. And that's what he's done exactly his entire 24 years. He's made an impact. As I talk about some of the things he's done today, I'd like to reflect on the impact that he has made on the mission, on the people, on the weapon systems, family, friends, and the community. It really made his mark. So before we take this journey down Mass Sergeant Moses' distinguished career, Dale, I'd like to personally thank you for asking me to officiate your ceremony on one of the greatest days of you and your family's life. I retired over 14 years ago, and to be invited back to officiate your ceremony is one of the highlights of my career. Like I said, I've had this uniform on only once in the last 14 years. So military members, anything's on backwards, don't say anything. I first met Dale 20 years ago in 1999, and I've watched him grow, you know, as an airman, a technician, learning the life support curriculum. He's gone on to be one of the experts in the life support curriculum. And before I get this wrong, too, they no longer call it life support. They call it AFE, Aircrew Flight Equipment. Did I get that right?
Yes, sir.
Got that right. Okay, that's one of many acronyms that we're going to go over today. I know a lot of the audience is civilians, so I'll try to break down all these acronyms if I know what they are. That's a challenge. Okay, in the military, when a member moves to a new duty station, they call it PCS, which is permanent change station. And generally, when you go to a new squadron, there's an orientation. In the 339th Flight Test Squadron, we had like an admin room, orderly room, A forms, and a bunch of operational units in there, basically comprised of four different weapon systems. And weapon system is the aircraft. So at Robbins, the equipment that Dale and his life support troops worked on were C-130 aircraft, which had four engines, propellers, C-141, which had four jet engines on it, and C-5 had four engines on it, and we had F-15 aircraft, which had two engines, had an ejection seat. And the reason I bring that up is because I want you to understand the criticality of the job that this man's done for 24 years. Each one of those aircraft are filled with life support equipment. And I think, you know, I can bore you with how much is on each aircraft. It's different. I think the C-130, isn't it like 30 different versions or something like that? You forgot already. You forgot already. There's like 30-something versions. Thank you, because I used to be the DO there. There's like 30-something versions. Well, anyway, your life support equipment is comprised of like your helmet, your mask, the raft that goes on the aircraft. Each aircraft has a different configuration. In that raft is critical equipment, flare gun, signaling mirror, desalinization kit to turn salt water to fresh water, rations, all the emergency equipment that goes on there, these guys are responsible for. And to be quite honest, it's one of those jobs that's like an unsung hero. We don't use it every day, but when you need it, you're glad you have it. That's exactly what happened. And we counted on these guys. And the mission at Robin was so diverse, because like I said, we had four different aircraft. So my hat's off to everything you guys do. One thing that I want to do a little different is normally this time, I'll usually go through his records, highlight some of the stuff he's done. But what I want to do is actually talk about three real world issues that happened out there that Dale and his team were personally responsible for. AJ, you in there? Is AJ out here?
Okay. Yeah.
You're part of the story. in the operational Air Force, the mission is basically to train the fight. At the depot, the mission is to get the aircraft back to the warfighter. So when an aircraft comes in here to depot, they strip it of everything. It's hydraulics, it's electric, they replace it. Dale and his team take off all the life support here and put it back on before we fly it again. I mean, they take the wing off in some cases, they put the engine back on, and when that happens, sometimes it doesn't get put back together. It's the way they took it apart. So, one time, we were doing a C-141 mission, and there's two pilots on board, two engineers. AJ happens to be one of the engineers. And we were finishing up, and we were about 18 miles south of the field here, about 18 miles south, about 20,000 feet up in the air. And when you're in a big aircraft, communication is key. And when you want to talk to somebody, you'll identify their position, then your position. So if I want to talk to an engineer, I'll say engineer or pilot. So everybody's listening on the radio knows I've identified the engineer on the pilot. So, and that's critical, you know, when you're in an emergency, because things get pretty chaotic pretty quick. So we're flying around, and like I say, we're south of the field, and I hear, pilot, engineer, do you, before you can finish, I knew what was happening. I said, crew, oxygen mask on, 100%. he smelled smoke, I smelled smoke, there was a fire on the aircraft. So like I said, we're about 20 miles south of the field. I turned the aircraft back to Robbins. AJ starts working with the other engineer who's a scanner, and we got to get that aircraft back to Robbins quick. There's nothing more dangerous to an aircraft than a fire. A lot of people think it's a like an aircraft engine fire, but it's not. You got four engines, just shut one down, you know. But that fire, that can get to you. So we turn the airplane back towards Robbins and push the power up. We get about 360 knots, and we deploy the spoilers. The spoilers are big panels on the aircraft. They deploy out and get a lot of drag, drop like an elevator. So we're like 6,000 feet per minute heading towards the Earth, about 6 miles a minute heading back to base. So theoretically, you know, we should get down on the ground in about 3 minutes and to the airbase 3 or 4 minutes, and that's what we're doing. To make matters worse, there was some weather between us and the airbase. We're sitting here breathing that oxygen. And right at that time, we're not thinking about anything, but how do we get that aircraft on the ground? And we do. We get the aircraft on the ground safely. We egress, which is when you just basically get off the aircraft as quick as you can. And by the time we landed, the aircraft had filled with smoke from the front to the back. That's what happened. So we got off the aircraft, our engines come, everything's taken care of. And I got to tell you right now, a lot of us kissed the ground that day because that was a scary day. And to this day, and I don't even know how I have all my hair. I certainly don't know why it's not gray. Other than you can take a little part of your big head. Take care of that. But the key part of this story is we were able to do that because of the life support equipment that Dell and the life support equipment had on the aircraft. But we did that bold base, which is universal in the military. Oxygen vest on 100%. We're breathing 100% oxygen, got the aircraft in the ground. You can imagine if one of those oxygen masks weren't working correctly or there was a leak. When you get that 100% oxygen, it keeps the smoke away. More importantly, if there had been some toxic fumes, you know, you can imagine what would have happened, we would have made it. My hat's off to you, Dale, and all the life support people that keep us safe when we have to find those aircraft every day. Another instance. Dale was stationed on a temporary duty over in Ballad Air Base, Iraq. And then his Department Commander, Lieutenant Colonel Williams, was flying an F-16 aircraft. And he was in the AOR, and the AOR is Air Responsibility, which is basically where the bad guys usually are. And then there's a line in there called the FEBA, which is a forward edge of the battle area. Once you're in there, you are in there with bad guys. If the aircraft goes down, you're with bad guys. Well, something happened to Dale's commander's aircraft, and we won't go into that, but he had to eject out of the aircraft. He parachuted down to the ground, made it home safely. And Dale's commander made it safely home to his family that day. And what I'd like to say is his commander, who was Lieutenant Colonel Williams at the time, went on to become Major General Williams. He's stationed in Korea now. He's chief of staff of the forces out there in Korea, right? And when he found about Dale's retirement, he sent him a quick little note. I'd like to read that. It says, "Thanks, Dale. Congratulations. You've been a great leader of our airmen. I'm grateful to have been able to serve with you. As a young tech sergeant, you turned around a dysfunctional life support team, and that team maintained the gear and equipment that saved my life. I will never forget our Panther team." Now, I need to repeat a portion of that last segment from then Lieutenant Colonel Williams, Major General Williams. "Maintained the gear and equipment saved my life." Dale's an impact player. There's no higher praise than that. No higher praise than that. And what I would like to say is, in addition to saving his life, saving an asset for the Air Force, his family's glad he's home. Another instance, Dale was stationed down at Moody Air Force Base, and I believe it was the Deputy Officer Commander, 06. He was on his A-10 aircraft. His aircraft became unflyable. He had to eject as well. Dale and his crew were credited with servicing, packing the life support equipment, the parachute to save that man's life. Again, Dale, an impact player. And I can't say enough about that because we all train to do our mission, but those are three instances where Dale was actually out there doing it. Get this mic up here, it makes a lot of noise. So, what I'd like to say on that is, when you're up there and you're having aircraft issues, it's not like driving a car. You can't pull up the side of the road, you can't look under the hood. You got to solve it. You got to get the aircraft underground. And, you know, if you happen to be close to the Earth, that's great. But sometimes you're out in the middle of the ocean. You got to rely on that life support gear that these guys take care of. Once again, like I said, you know, you guys have done a phenomenal job. And I guarantee you, when those two airmen were floating through the air with that parachute, it doesn't matter if it was 10,000 feet, 40,000 feet. All they wanted to look up and see was that parachute path correctly. And that's what Dell and his team has done every day. Before I go on here real quick, I see quite a few members of the 339th Flight Test Squadron. Would you guys mind standing up for a second, standing up, people from the 339th Flight Test Squadron? Okay, there's like six of you. Okay, go ahead and sit down. What I wanted to point out is that these folks here served Dale, many of them over 20 years ago, and they went on to retire, they moved out of state, but they came back to watch this man retire today. That says a lot about Dale. You know, anybody can go out there and lead, but Dale made an impact on those people, just like as he has me as a man. So that's outstanding. Okay, now I'd like to go into a couple of those official dry things in your EPRs and decorations. Before I get into this, I want you to know the acronyms here. I don't even know if I know all the acronyms, but I'll do my best. But just give me a little warning. When Dale first sees the 339, he can hit the ground running. From day one, they recognize his talent. And his commanders and supervisors pushed him to go to the Air Force Academy prep school. And I can tell you, being a commander myself, that doesn't happen to a young airman that quick. But my hat's off to you. They knew they had the talent. Another one of Dale's first big achievements was he was recognized for in his career was he won the AFMC Headquarters 1998 AFMC Air Crew Life Support Airman of the Year Award. And just so you understand that, the AFMC is comprised of, you have a bunch of squadrons, make up a wing, make up a numbered Air Force, make up the command. Well, Dale, you know, won the Air Crew Life Support Airman of the Year Award. While still in the 339th, he was nominated to compete for the Air Force's 10 Outstanding Airmen of the Year Award. Same thing, squadron, wing, NAF, command, all those commands make up the Air Force. That's what this man did early in his career, impact player. Later, when he was assigned overseas, he, and I quote, his efforts led to two consecutive PACAF Life Support of the Year Awards. PACAF is just basically a bunch of bases out in the Pacific Ocean, starting with Hawaii, Guam, Japan, but even two consecutive PACAF Life Support of the Year Awards, impact player. Dale was also cited as, and I quote, being critical to the overall excellent rating for the 35th Fighter Wing in the 2007 PACAF ORI. ORI is Operational Readiness Inspection, which is basically where you simulate combat. You getting it up with these acronyms yet? But again, Dale, he's being an impact player. He was the 23rd Fighter Group's nominee for ACC's AFE NCO of the Year. That's Air Combat Command, Air Crew Fighting Equipment, Non-Commissioned Officer. Some awful acronyms, don't ask me to repeat it, and I'm going to. He was also the AFE Non-Commissioned Officer of the Year in 2010 and the 23rd Fighter Group NCO of the Year in 2010. Just an outstanding job. Everywhere you go, Dale done a fantastic job. Dale was also, and I quote, lauded for leading a flawless flight chemical mitigation weapons procedure, which led to an excellent rating in the ACC SAF, which is Staff Assistant, which is kind of fight the war. The paperwork is the way I kind of looked at that. But every assignment, every TDY, every duty location, Dale has always made an impact. That's just a few of the professional highlights I pulled out of his records. There's so many things I could pull out. I mean, Dale, you had about 20 other things I could pull out, but I'm not going to go through that because I think we have a little food out there. We do have some food out there. Right? So, just want to get a ticket. Dessert, we're going to have some food out there. Just want to say. Okay, now I want to switch gears for a second, go over some of his out of uniform accomplishments. I quote Dale, he was a community leader, a bi-monthly volunteer with the Alberta Healthcare Center, helping the underprivileged elderly and families, impacted the community. He was a RE, R-E-A-D, Foundation Member Volunteer, mentored elementary children with their reading skills impact. He coached soccer, basketball, and football. He supported the local state community activities. He was the head judge for the Georgia High School AFROTC statewide drill competition, where he chaired four drill teams, eight different teams, 11 drills, mentoring 300 cadets in 9 separate high schools. Again, I can't emphasize enough, whether he was in uniform or he's out of uniform, Dale has always, always made an impact. There's none better. One of the proudest achievements that Dale had when he was in the military, and I mean, it's really one of his proudest, his eyes light up when he talks about this, is when he was nominated for the Big Meritorious Service Award. And Big stands for Blacks in Government. The Big Award honors military members and DOD civilian employees who have epitomized the qualities and core values of the military service. It recognizes members who have demonstrated outstanding support of their mission and organization by demonstrating full support and integration for the promotion of African Americans within the armed forces and federal civilian workforce. He represented the Air Force well here, an impact player. Made it all the way to the top. Outstanding job. Well, as I said, Dale told me that leaving the civilian sector to become an airman 24 years ago was the hardest decision he ever made. But that's until now, when he and his family made the decision for him to leave the service that he loves so much. So to Senior Master Sergeant and wife, Jamisa, daughter, London, who, by the way, is graduating from nursing school this month from the University of Alabama, Birmingham. Eldest son, Demarius, who's a sophomore at Phillips College. Youngest son, Dimitri, who's a sophomore in high school. We thank you for supporting Dale throughout his challenging and outstanding career. Getting close to the end now, where we're getting close. I hope the food's still warm. We have warm food, right? I think you have warm food.
Cold cuts,
okay. Okay. Well, before we press on, though, I want to go off script for just 1 second. You guys are all familiar with that phrase, it takes a village to raise a family. Well, that was certainly true in Dale's case. In addition to his parents, Pamela, Moses Todd, and Mr. Q. Beavers, Dale's grandmother, Mrs. Willie Dean Jackson, and his late grandfather, Mr. Willie Albert Jackson, were also instrumental in helping raise Dale. Anyone who knows Dale knows the strong influence his grandparents had on him, you know, when they were helping raise Dale. When I was talking to Dale in one of my conversations, I found out that his grandfather worked for the Coca-Cola company for 38 years. And that was kind of near and dear to me because he read the program. When I left the military, I actually flew for the Coca-Cola program, department for 12 years. And my whole life, I mean, you know, collecting things, coins, comic books, stamps, stuff like that. And before I even thought of coming to, going to Coca-Cola, I found these two, which they told me were antique music boxes from Coca-Cola, and I put them away in my storage unit. And when I got the opportunity to do this, and I talked to Dale, I thought, wow, can we go get that little music box out? And I did, and it was old. You know, it had been opened a few times, but it was probably sent up from the store. I opened it up and I looked for the battery compartment. No battery compartment, that's how old it is, but you plug it in. And I plugged it in and it worked. You know, this little Coke bottle would move around, a little going, and it actually plays a catchy little tune, and some of you guys are probably familiar with this tune.
Bring back a few memories for some of you folks. Better home for this box than to give this to Willie Dean Jackson. And what I want
you to know is every time you play this box, I want you to think about the day your grandson retired and the role that you and your late husband played in helping raise, you know, this fine young man. It's outstanding. Chief of Staff of the Air Force, Commander Chief of the Armed Forces, the former Commander Chief of the Armed Forces, President Barack Obama, whom I think signed the retirement certificate you're being presented today, the men and women who served with me, we all thank you for serving the greatest Air Force in the world. It's about time for us to take our positions here, Dale. Are you ready?
Yes, sir.
You ready?
I'm ready.
You can't do it crying now. I had a line here to say, are you going to get choked up if we pass that stage? This is going to be good for you, man. This is going to be good. You're going to be able to look back on your career. This is going to be a great thing. We're going to take your 6 stripes, help you return them, put them in the closet. And we're going to reintroduce you back to your family and friends just the same way you entered the military 24 years ago. It's Delvecchio, Coco, Moses.
Ladies and gentlemen, please rise as Colonel Pennant presents a mandatory service medal to Master Sergeant Moses. Master Sergeant Delvecchio N. Moses distinguished himself in the performance of outstanding service to the United States while assigned to the 350th Special Warfare Training Squadron, Special Warfare Training Group, Special Warfare Training Wing. During this period, Master Sergeant Moses led a multi-squadron storage merger obtained a $424,000 storage apparatus to secure 1,500 uniform items outfitting 140 personnel. He also directed assistance to the 351st Special Warfare Training Squadron by executing 232 parachute repacks, which enabled training for 34 jumpers and produced 24 combat rescue officer and pararescue school graduates. In addition, Sergeant Moses oversaw the repairs of emergency flotation devices, overhauling and testing 20 units, and saving $24,600 in replacement costs. Furthermore, he guided inspection cycle and accountability of 120 personnel parachute systems in support of 207 jumps across 2 squadrons, maintaining training qualifications for 84 operators. Finally, Sergeant Moses coordinated with the Defense Logistics Agency to track and document 86 aircraft flight equipment items, ultimately redistributing $250,000 worth of parachute assets. The singularly distinguished accomplishments of Sergeant Moses culminate a distinguished career in the service of his country and reflect great credit upon himself and the United States government. Lieutenant Colonel Clemens will now direct the publishing of the retirement order.
Publish the order.
Attention to orders. Special Order Number AC-000167, dated 4 October 2018. By order of the Secretary of Air Force, Master Sergeant Delvecchio N. Moses, you are relieved from active duty and retired effective 1 September 2019 after 24 years and 28 days of faithful and honorable service. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Sergeant Moses will now receive certificates of appreciation for his service. First one reads, I extend to you my personal thanks and the sincere appreciation of a grateful nation for your contributions honorable service to our country. You have helped maintain the security of our nation during a critical time in its history with a devotion to duty and spirit of sacrifice in keeping with the proud traditions of military service. Your commitment and dedication have been an inspiration for those who will follow in your footsteps and for all Americans who join me in today in saluting you for a job extremely well done. My best wishes to you for happiness and success in the future. Signed, Barack H. Obama, 44th Commander-in-Chief. Additionally, Master Sergeant Moses received personal congratulatory letters from Presidents, the Secretary of the Air Force, the Chief of Staff of the Air Force, the Chief Master Sergeant of the Air Force, the Governor of Georgia, and the Mayor of the great city of Atlanta, Keisha Lance Bottoms, which are displayed on the table in the rotunda near the F-15 fighter jet display. Okay. A significant part of retirement ceremony is the presentation of the retirement. Mrs. Moses, will you please come forward? The pen symbolizes the end of one chapter of our lives and the beginning of another. It represents the contributions of over 24 years of service to our country. It's not gaudy because one service is not for recognition. A casual observer may not notice it, but those with a keen eye will see the holidays spent alone on distant continents and the endless hours spent enduring the readiness of our military might. Honing the skills and professionalism of fellow comrades at arms, Master Sergeant Moses, when that keen eye person gives you that knowing nod, feel as good about your choice to serve as we will feel about having served with you. Mrs. Moses, the honor of placing the pen on your husband's lapel is all yours. It is customary in the Air Force that we present Master Sergeant Moses' spouse with an Air Force Certificate of Appreciation for the sacrifice she has made and support she has given her husband throughout his career. Certificate reads as follows. In grateful appreciation, the United States Air Force represents this certificate of recognition to Tremisa T. Moses for the commitment and numerous contributions that made positive impacts to the nation's defense. Thank you for your support, which gave strength and purpose to your spouse's service. Signed, Caleb O. Wright, Chief Master Sergeant of the United States Air Force.
Additionally, Mrs. Moses also received certificates of appreciation from the Secretary of the Air Force, the Chief of Staff of the Air Force, and many others. At this time, we would like to invite London, Damaris, and Dimitri to come forward. For their sacrifice, Master Sergeant Moore would like to present his children with the Military Child Medal. The Military Child Medal reads, throughout the years of your life, you have made sacrifices and you have served your country as much as I have done. In your loving way, you quietly shouldered the heavy burden that you were asked to carry. Most of the time, you could not understand why I was not there, but you quietly hid the tears. Courageously put on a smile and defiantly promised that you would support me. I missed so many holidays and countless special occasions while you were left at home to work while I was on difficult missions. You had to say goodbye to friends when we moved throughout the years, and you had to change schools. Your resilience and self-confidence throughout those frequent moves gave you strength. There is no way that I could have been a success in my military career without having support, your understanding, and most importantly, your unquestionable love. Thank you for being there. At this time, we'll have a special presentation. A1C Davis Reed will present Sergeant Moses with a shadow box. The shadow box is a rich military tradition. The shadow box, as its name implies, the shadow of a military career. The oak wooden case represents the solid leadership you have provided for many airmen over the last 24 years. The glass covering the front of the shadow box reminds us of the unique way Air Force CNCOs sees through problems and find the solutions. The blue felt, the background, stands for the many airmen and officers you have mentored throughout your Air Force career. The stained Air Force symbol stands out for the diligence, hard work, and strongest commitment to principles. The decorations tell us of a great portion of yourself you gave given our country over the years and the military members most honored and cherished possession, the United States flag. It symbolizes the freedom we all enjoy because of your dedication and the dedication of others like you. Accepted, protected, guarded, and remembered that the young men and women you have trained, guided, and inspired will follow in your footsteps and defend it with equal pride. Ladies and gentlemen, please remain seated as Robins Air Force Base Honor Guard team come forward for a special flag presentation. The Honor Guard will present Master Sergeant Moses with a memento that has special significance to a retired member of the Armed Forces, the American flag. Unity, as well as a source of pride and inspiration for millions of citizens. Born on June 14, 1776, between 7 red and white. And the union be 13 stars, white in the blue field, represent the new constellation. Between 1777 and 1960, the shape and design of the flag evolved into the flag presented before you today. The 13 horizontal stripes represent the 13 original colonies, while the stars represent the 50 states of the Union. The colors of the flag are symbolic as well. The red symbolizes hardness and valor, white signifies purity and innocence, and blue represents vigilance, perseverance, and justice. Traditionally, a symbol of liberty, the American flag has carried the message of freedom and inspired Americans both at home and abroad. In 1814, Francis Key Scott was so moved at seeing the Stars and Stripes waving after the British shelling of Baltimore's Fort McHenry that he wrote the words of Star Spangled Banner. In 1892, the flag inspired Francis Bellamy to write the Pledge of Allegiance, our most famous flag salute and patriotic oath. In July 1969, the American flag was flown in space when Neil Armstrong planted it on the surface of the moon. Today, our flag flies on a constellation of Alpha satellites that circle our globe and on the thin flash of our aircraft in harm's way in every corner of the world. Indeed, it flies in the heart of every airman who serves our great nation. The sun never sets on the U.S. Air Force, nor on the flag we so proudly cherish. Since 1776, no generation of Americans have been spared the responsibility of defending freedom. Today, airmen remain committed to preserving the freedom that others won for us for generations to come. By displaying the flag and giving it distinctive fold, we show respect to the flag and express our gratitude to those individuals who fought and continue to fight for freedom at home and abroad. Since the dawn of the 20th century, airmen have proudly flown the flag in every major conflict on land and in skies around the world. It is our responsibility, it is their responsibility to continue to protect and preserve the rights, privileges, and freedoms that we as Americans enjoy today. The United States flag represents who we are. It stands for the freedom we all share and the pride and patriotism we feel for our country. We cherish its legacy as a beacon of hope to one and all. Long may it wave. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to introduce to you Master Sergeant Delvecchio Moses, United States Air Force retired. This is for him. That chair right there is for him. He's in the place. That river represented him, and that Coca-Cola hat represented him as well. So, just to thank you, I didn't come quick. Taught me everything I know. The village that you talked about, sir, it was a village in my household. My mom, my grandma, my dad, everyone was a part of my life. But when it comes times to have honor and integrity, that's the person that taught me that. Because I watched him be a great husband, a father, a provider, everything that I ever wanted to be to my family. And so that's what that represents. So, Grandma, I love you. Mom, I love you. Grandma, I love you. Mom, I love you. So thank y'all so much for being here today. It really means a lot to me. Okay. For people that know me, and some of you that haven't heard the story, you can read those bios, but what I want to tell you about me is I'm from the city of Atlanta, and you talk about the toughest decision I've made in my life, sir, it was. At the time, it was 18, I went into the delay enlistment program, like you mentioned, and it was difficult. It was a sacrifice for my family to let me go. But I hope I made you proud. I hope that I honor you today, and knowing where I stand for you, man. Okay, I love you. For my wife,
kids, those are my pillars. Those are my cornerstones. They hold me up. They protect me when the world is against me. I love you. Dimitri, you the young Thundercat. You got it. It's time to take off. I hang you all the way. I love you. Okay. For that, I have something for you. Something for me. No cause given out today. Dimitri, you gotta wait. Demarius, I'm proud of you, man. You changed from that 15 to that 19. I know every bit of you trying to be all the opposite of me. And I love that about you. I love that you're strong, you're confident, and you always caring. Keep paving your own way and ride down your own lane. The opportunities are already there. Limitless. I love you. London, our most needy child. Is. But that's in a great way. I love him. I'm so happy to have him coming back so that we can spend some personal time together. I know it's been difficult for you to watch us as a family while you're geographically separated from us, but you've been doing your thing. You've been grinding in silence. You know, you're not out publicizing what you're doing. You leave that to us, and you buckle down and you did what you had to do. For that, I ain't trying to get sick no time soon. Congratulations on your career. You're going to be the best nurse that I ever have known. I love you. She works in silence, just like a daughter. She falls right behind me. But this woman, when again the world is against me, and when I'm most vulnerable, she's the one that knows that. I just come home and I lay on her lap and I say, I need you to scratch my head. We don't talk about work in the house, but she knows that I have had a bad day, and she let me lie there. And not only that, she's not at home waiting on me. She's working, doing the same thing that I'm doing. Leaving the house at 5 o'clock in the morning. Coming home in the evening at 7 o'clock in the evening. But thanks for letting me lay on your lap. Hope you enjoy your gifts. You are my world. You pull more towards me as I pull more towards you. And I'm looking forward to our future together. And we'll see if you're going to retire next year. So I didn't write anything down, so that was, I want to make sure I got that emotional part out. So if you had the right number how many times I was going to cry, collect your money. Crying is done. So Colonel Clemens, sir, I have something special for you. He's here as well. Always there, interceding on my behalf if I need anything. daughter going to college in Birmingham, where he's from. We cut from the same cloth. Whenever I need him, he's gonna say anything else. So thank you. Feel the depth. I love you, brother. Certainly not least, I want to take this moment to recognize my dad. You come forward, Dad. All right, so my dad, he don't say much either, but we're both Leos. He started off on the 23rd. I am everything of him, just as my son is everything of me. So proud to have you as my father. And I just want you to know that I love you. I'm glad that you're in my life. And this is when I need you the most. And I'm glad that you're present. So this is wheelchair parent bill presented to you just for your sacrifices as a parent, recognizing that your son went off to go to the military and sacrifice for you to let me go. And I love you too. Best auntie in the world. I love you. Those three right there, y'all fortunate. Okay? Protect her. Love her. My youngest sister, Kanaya, I love you. She's done great things, ROTC, and we're going to be looking to get her to the blue as well. So, you're the future, and the future is now. Alright? I love you. My brother, great to have you present, man. I love you. We got so much life to live together. Looking forward to those times. Thank you for being here. I love you. I just thank y'all for not bothering me, praying for me, praising me, just not causing any confusion in my household. I thank you for being supportive. I love y'all. I love you, Grandpa. I love you, Mama. I love you to my beautiful niece. Thank you. To my family, coming behind on the second row here, I got cousin serving in the military just as me. You on deck. You're trying to go come. Faith. So, my proper, that's my nephew. That's my best man's son. He's coming up. He's going to be a senior. He's coming here in September. He's on the honor guard. It's an honor and a privilege to have you do this. It's a great honor, and I hope that he honors your grandparents by having you here today. Proud of you, man. She said, hey, talk to him. I got it. Hey, I'm proud of you. Whatever your future may hold, you're going to be the best at it. You're going to be the best at whatever you do. And if you ever need anything, I'm here for you. And I love you. So behind the scenes in the shadows over here, this is my sister. We just started a life of love in Japan, and I thank you for being here. I thank you for your sacrifice. I thank you for your service. know, there's a all-white celebration later. There's dress code. I have more things to say there because somebody probably got a bet on how long we're going to talk. That's why I didn't write anything down. Because I would have been forever. So to my East Side family, I love y'all, my brothers, they right there. You know, Decatur is not great. Everybody know the West Side is the best side. Everybody know where the mirror come from. Alright? She is an Astro, just so you know. My cousins, I love y'all. Huh? You rock. You rock, huh? For real. Amongst all the women, you rock. Whether you want to hold it or not, you got to rock. And I love you. My aunt, my cousins, thank y'all. Y'all don't have to do it, but you thought of me. And in that, I'm thinking of you, and I love you. I love you. My first supervisor, Shannon Blaine, is starting right here. I'm not certain if he's in here in the audience or not. But Brian Lloyd, he's right here. His daughter Brianna, beautiful voice. Thank you. I'm here along with Martin Shannon we have there, just in the shop with me. These people took care of me, so that's what means a lot to me. You know, I was 18, I was young. I got stationed back at my first duty station, hour 15 minutes away from home. And if anybody knows me, they'll tell you on Friday, I had some basketball shorts, some flip flops, and my dirty clothes in the car. And I was gone. And the only person that was standing between me was this guy. That is true. But I love you for that. And I made sure that I did those TO refiles. So for that, I just want to thank everybody. Thank you for making me the person who I am. It's a family. Me, I'm a transparent, servant, leader. And I'll always be here with you. People take care of people, and we got to love one another. So in closing in this, I don't have any quote, because I didn't write anything down. And I'm getting old, and everything is in my iPhone, and it turned off. So thank you for coming. I love you. And I think there's something else after this. I don't have a script.
That's it.
That's it? All right. I love y'all. Thank you so much.
Off we go into the wild blue yonder, flying high.